Krishna. My name is Krishna Prana, devi dasi. I am the director of intimate partner abuse prevention for the Vaishnavi ministry, and I'm here today to talk about the different types of abuse. So to review, in case you've seen any of the previous videos, we've chosen this term intimate partner abuse for our project, and abuse, to give a very loose definition, is a pattern or behavior in an intimate partner relationship that is used by one partner to gain or maintain control or power over another partner. So that's intimate partner abuse. And we've chosen this term intimate partner abuse rather than domestic abuse, domestic violence, gender-based violence, because we just found it to be a more inclusive term. For example, if somebody is only dating or associating, they're not actually married, or in a domestic situation where they're living each other, these services that we're offering would still be applicable. And we just want to make that known by using this type of inclusive term. We also use this term to indicate that it's more than just about physical and sexual violence. And a term like gender-based violence, domestic violence, those terms do include other types of abuse, but for the common person that might not be as known, and then they might not know to get help or that they're eligible to get help. So that's why we've used the term intimate partner abuse, so that it's not only physical or sexual violence that can fall under it, but also emotional, psychological, spiritual types of abuse. And we'll get into all those different types of abuse today in this video. So there are many different types of abuse that I've already alluded to. However, a lot of the time when we think of abuse, we might only think of sexual and physical abuse because they're the most easily identifiable. They're often the most talked about types of abuse. And it's really unfortunate that the other types of abuse might get brushed under the radar or be minimized. And we absolutely don't want that, because there's no better or worse type of abuse. Abuse is abuse, and it's all horrible and not to be condoned in any way. So we're going to break it down into the different types of abuse. And if you'd like to know the reference that I'm citing from here, you can Google power and control wheel, and you'll be able to get a breakdown on all the different types of abuse, especially if you search in Google images. So to start off, we'll talk about intimidation. So examples of intimidation: making someone feel afraid by using looks, actions, or gestures, destroying objects, abusing pets, displaying weapons. Again, we're not actually using any of these objects or gestures to apply force, like it would be in physical abuse, but it's still creating that effect of fear, and the woman might feel controlled through these uses of intimidation. Another type of abuse is, of course, emotional abuse. And you could argue that a lot of these categories I'm talking about fall under this category of emotional abuse. So here are a few examples of what could fall under this category. So putting the woman down, making her feel bad about herself, name calling, making her think she's crazy, playing mind games, humiliating her, and making her feel guilty. These are examples of emotional abuse. A separate category within the wheel would be minimizing, denying, and blaming. Again, this could be seen as emotional or psychological abuse. So examples of minimizing, denying, and blaming: making light of the abuse, not taking her concerns seriously, saying that she even caused it, or saying it didn't happen, saying it was her fault when it actually wasn't. These are all examples of minimizing, denying, and blaming. And I would say this is one of the more common presentations of abuse that we might see, because one of the main common factors that we see in abusive men is this quality to not take ownership of their behavior, right? And that's the reason that these men, unfortunately, don't change, because in order to change, you have to admit that you have a problem, take ownership of it, and then get help. And why would you get help if you're not going to take ownership of it? So Again, this minimizing, denying, blaming, probably one of the most popular types of abuse that I see in my work as a clinical counselor. Another type of abuse, using children. So making her feel guilty about the children, using the children to relay inappropriate messages. And when we think about it, any message could be deemed as inappropriate because it's not a child's job to be the messenger between mom and dad. That's not fair to the child. If the couple is separated, using visitation to harass her, threatening to take the children away or harm them if he doesn't get what he wants. These are all examples of using children to abuse, to get control. Then another category we have is male privilege. So treating her like a servant, insisting on making all the big decisions, being the one that defines men's and women's roles. In our ISKCON movement, this is where we might see an overlap with spiritual abuse, which we'll get to in a moment. We're going to talk about scripture bending and how that idea can be used to misapply some of the ideas in Prabhupada's books. And unfortunately, it becomes male privilege, right? Like I said, using scripture to justify treating her like a servant or defining men and women's roles in these inappropriate and incorrect ways. So we'll talk about that in a moment. Another type of abuse, coercion and threats. So making and or carrying out threats to do something to hurt her, to also hurt her position, for example, like blackmailing her, if you don't do this, I'm gonna tell everybody at the temple this thing about you, or I'm gonna tell your family this thing about you, threatening to leave her, threatening to commit suicide, making her do illegal things. These are all examples of coercion and threats, and kind of goes hand in hand with that intimidation category that we talked about a little while ago. And then, as I mentioned, we also have spiritual abuse. So this is a big one in our movement, unfortunately. So using scripture to justify controlling behavior or justify how the role of men and women should be. So that would be scripture bending, right? Using spiritual philosophy, misapplied spiritual philosophy, to blame or shame or judge her into getting his way. This can be extremely harmful and, of course, create a crisis of faith, excuse me, within the woman. So not only is she being abused and possibly being emotionally, physically harmed, but in addition, she can be spiritually harmed in this way. So spiritual abuse is extremely threatening in that sense. And then we have economic abuse. So examples of that, preventing her from getting a job, making her ask for money or giving her an allowance that she's only allowed to have or spend a certain amount of money per week, often, which isn't enough to get the things she needs, like sufficient money for groceries, that sort of thing. Taking her money is another example, not letting her know about or have access to family income. These are all examples of economic, or we also call it financial abuse. And of course, that can go hand in hand with the male privilege piece as well, you know, trying to apply ideas, well, I'm the man and I should have access to all of our funds. I should be in charge. I should be in control. You should be subservient or submissive to me, right? And that's where that scripture bending might come in as well. So we see that a lot of these types of abuse might be overlapping with one another. And let's talk about some symptoms of abuse. So like I mentioned earlier, the essence of any kind of abuse is power or control, to gain power or control over another person. And there are external and internal symptoms of abuse. So externally, if I get the sense that this person is trying to gain power or control over me in some way, then that could be an external symptom of abuse. And like I said before, a great resource is the power and control wheel. You can go on Google Images to find that. It's a very well-known resource, and you can go through that wheel, and if you realize that he might be doing one of those things, one or more of those things within that wheel, that would be an indicator that there's some type of abuse going on. And that can be a really helpful resource because in a sense, it really is quite black and white to see it in front of you in that way. So that can be really helpful, especially when we might be feeling crazy, or we might be feeling like it's our fault because he's done such a good job at manipulating us, or that minimizing, denying, and blaming type of abuse, making us believe that it's our fault. And so that leads us to the internal symptoms. When I check in with my body around this person, do I feel a sense of safety and calm? Right? Talking about emotional safety, not having to worry about my physical safety being put at risk, feeling like I can be myself without dangerous consequences around this person. These are all indications that emotional safety would be there. And if I'm feeling emotionally unsafe inside, could it be due to one of the types of abuse that we went through earlier on in this video, or in that power and control wheel? And these are all enough to make anyone feel emotionally unsafe, even if he might just be doing one of those abusive behaviors. So it would be important to look at a resource like that. And it's very common, like I said, for women to feel like they're going crazy because he might have made her believe that it's her fault, even though she has had an internal knowing that it's not. He might just be really good at that psychological abuse, emotional manipulation piece that she just has learned to believe it's her fault. And so that can also be a really common symptom that there may be some kind of abuse going on. And let's say you're in a situation where you've gone through that power and control wheel and he's not doing any of those abusive behaviors, but there's still some indication that you might be feeling unsafe inside. It's possible that you may be triggered due to some sort of past trauma, in which case it would be really helpful to seek some kind of professional support, like trauma therapy, counseling, that sort of thing. And it may be possible that there may be some kind of unhealthy behavior going on in your relationship, but that it's not necessarily abuse, right? So it would still be helpful to seek some sort of professional help or guidance, so you can be supported in whatever situation you're in. So I hope you found this helpful. And like I said, please check out the power and control wheel. And if you'd like a contrasting wheel to look at to see what should be in a healthy relationship, what are the healthy indicators that would be there, you can Google equality wheel. And so thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama.
Hare Hare, Hare Rama.